This is Harriet Grayson, your host and producer of Community Culture Showcase. And I like to have some very interesting programs just to kind of get you excited about what's around in our community. And today, I have with me an extraordinary musician who is going to introduce my audience to an instrument that you rarely see performed, but in fact is having something of a renaissance, as we can say, because it's an instrument of that piece and time. So I have with me Elena, and Elena is going to describe for us and talk about harpsichords. And when you think of the Bach, you think of the harpsichord. But here we have actually have a factory in our local community that is producing these beautiful instruments. So I want to introduce Elena, and because she has this very long Russian name, I'm going to let her pronounce her last name and tell us a little bit about the harpsichord.
Well, my last name is Zamolodchikova, but you don't have to learn that last name. So the harpsichord, you can see, you can't really see from here, but it has a keyboard, and it has strings, and it's shaped a lot like a piano. So what it is, it's actually a predecessor of a piano. And the piano emerged directly from this type of the instrument, the harpsichord. The fundamental difference between a harpsichord and a piano is that on the piano, as probably most of you know, because probably most of you looked inside of the piano while it's being played. So the hammers strike the strings. And depending on how hard you push the key, you can have a softer and a louder sound. And in the harpsichord, what happens is that the so-called jacks, which are just pieces of wood, and I can show them now.
Yeah, if you'd like. Sure.
Yes, absolutely. So in the harpsichord, I'm going to open the action for you so you can see how it works. The string is actually plucked by this piece of wood called a jack. So you get this interesting kind of shrill, but
yes,
very
like a
nice,
shrilly sound. It's
shrilly
like
sound.
High pitch on a harpsichord.
That's right.
As a listener, that would be something that you can hear very distinctly.
Right, exactly. So I'm going to show the jack what it looks like. So it's pretty much just a piece of wood. I don't know if you can see on camera, but there's a little piece of plastic sticking out. Thank you. Sticking out right here. Yeah, here it is. This black thing. Here, this is a piece of plastic. And that's what actually plucks the string. When the jack goes up, you press the key down, jack goes up. It plucks the string, and the plastic pretty much goes like this with it. So I'll try to demonstrate. So it plucks the string, and when it goes down, this interesting system actually makes it go back like this.
Yeah.
It's called a tongue. Mm-hmm. And that's why it does not get stuck. It rather falls down, it passes by the string, falls back into a place so you can press the key again, and it will pluck again. So I will show you again. So here it plucks, and then it releases, and it goes past the string, falls down again. Here it goes.
And you get that high-pitched sound.
And you get this high-pitched sound, and this piece of felt at the end of the jack is actually the damper. That's all we need for a damper for a harpsichord, because the strings are much thinner than on the piano. And it doesn't need all this big, heavy piece of wood with a lot of material on it, as you need for the piano to dampen all the strings in the piano. As you, many of you know, when the hammer goes up, it actually strikes at least, it strikes three strings at once. So to dampen all of that sound, you need a lot of felt. Here, you just need this little tiny piece. That's all you need. And that's pretty much it. It's very simple.
It's a simple instrument for the times, coming out in terms of the Renaissance in Europe.
Right. The first mentioning of an instrument is in 14th century, and the first surviving instrument from the time that actually has an action in it is, I believe, is 1521. Mm-hmm. And it's this type of the harpsichord is called an Italian harpsichord. And actually that the earliest surviving instruments are also Italian instruments. But as far as I know, they actually did not appear in Italy. Italy picked them up from Flanders. But then Flanders picked it up from Italy because they started developing in Italy. Italian instruments, as you can see, maybe from the camera, the strings, all the strings on the Italian instrument are made out of brass. So they're all yellow in color. On the later type of instruments, which are Flemish and French, which I don't have any of them today, but maybe in the future, they also have soft iron strings. And to compare, the modern piano strings are very thick, heavy, and I believe they're also made out of iron, but it's a much harder iron than what you use for harpsichord. And the brass is even softer than the soft iron, so this is a really soft material for the strings.
Does it have the same number of keys, like 88, that the piano
that's
has?
That's a great question. It does not.
Okay.
And what's interesting is that the harpsichords come in all kinds of shapes and all kinds of numbers for the keys. So this particular one, I believe, has 52 keys as opposed to 88, so much less, as you can imagine.
Yes.
But for the music of that time, you don't need more.
Right.
And
right.
You wouldn't play Liszt or Chopin on this kind of instrument. Mm-hmm. Would not sound good. So it has much less keys. On the later instruments, you can have up to 63 keys, but okay. That's pretty much
the
maximum you have on the harpsichord.
All right.
And that's the beginning of the harpsichord, and I will talk more about the history later.
Okay.
So maybe
how about playing a piece?
Yes, sure.
So. Let us hear some music from there. When I think of a harpsichord, I do think of Bach. Is that the most famous? Now, he's actually German.
Right.
So, is he the most famous musician who used the harpsichord?
Absolutely, he's the most famous. There are plenty of other composers, you would be surprised, but actually, harpsichords went out of fashion in the beginning of 19th century. So, up until then, composers composed for harpsichords, so Haydn and Mozart.
Composed. Mozart and Haydn, okay.
Yeah, they still compose for harpsichord. Beethoven, he might have had some really early pieces for harpsichord, but then he really switched to piano, and he was the one actually developing music for piano. So that's...
Okay. A little music history for our audience.
Yeah.
Yes.
So since we were talking about Bach, the piece I'm going to perform right now is... I decided to try it from to start from something that most of you are probably familiar with. It's the Prelude and Fugue from the first book of the Well-Tempered Clavier, written by Bach, and it's written to be performed on any kind of keyboard instrument of the time. So it could be performed on both harpsichord and organ. And this prelude is actually famous because that's the famous Ave Maria prelude that everyone knows. And the melody for this prelude was composed much later in 19th century by Charles Gounod.
Oh.
He's famous for his opera Faust. But originally, that's how it sounded. And I'm going to be playing both prelude and fugue because that's how you play them. You never really play only the prelude.
Okay.
Well-tempered clavier consists out of the first book 24 and the second book 24 preludes and fugues, and you always play them in pairs.
Okay.
So that's why I'm going to be playing them in pairs.
A little music education. Yeah. Beautiful. Beautiful.
Thank you.
So what accounts for the sudden, I think of it as sudden, renewed interest in instruments like this? I mean, there's so many more groups around doing early music.
You're just keep asking excellent questions, I have to say. Well, the reason is I think that people get bored.
Okay.
I think that's a very simple reason why. So as I said, the interest to harpsichord ceased in the beginning of 19th century, and the piano got a very excessive development.
Mm-hmm.
And we ended up with this huge instruments that sound very loud, could fill up huge holes. But eventually, there were some people who started thinking, well, there was this instrument harpsichord before, and there are this, many of the antique instruments arriving that could still be played, mm-hmm. you know, if you restore them. And some people just started, you know, getting interested again in the forgotten instrument, you know,
right.
as it's the same as any, probably any area of art, any field of art where you have certain movements and then suddenly you think, oh, actually, but Renaissance had beautiful art at the time, and you suddenly
right.
start getting interested.
Get back into it.
That's what happened actually in the Renaissance times. They were interested with the, Greek art.
Right.
They just decided to come back to that because it was beautiful. So, just to name a couple of names, one of the most prominent, people who, started developing a harpsichord again was Arnold Dolmetsch. And there are a few of his instruments still around, and they were not exactly copies of the antique instruments. That's
right.
what we do now. But they were very close, and they were still very interesting, very well-made instruments. And one of the most famous players who started playing harpsichords again was Wanda Landowska. And this name is probably familiar to many of you. She wasn't playing this type of instruments, which is a historical copy, and it
mm-hmm.
sounds as close as you can get to an antique instrument.
Right.
She was playing huge instruments that were looking very much like pianos.
Right.
And they were very heavy, they were way overbuilt, very complicated, and they didn't have nearly as much sound, despite of all the build up they had. And they were made by a piano factory called Pleyel, a very famous piano factory in France, I believe in Paris. And then people slowly started coming up again with the copies of the antique instruments and
introducing them.
And just the more people got involved, the more people, the more people heard about it, the more people became mm-hmm. interested. Like, I'm one of them, you know. Mm-hmm. I started as a pianist and I still play piano. But I got into playing these instruments. And actually what I love about playing them is, first of all, they're all different.
Mm-hmm.
Pianos are, you know, any modern piano you take, they're very close to each other.
Okay.
You won't be able, from just hearing a piano, you wouldn't be able to tell if it's a Steinway, it's a Kawai, if it's a Bechstein, you know, Blüthner, any, you wouldn't be able to tell.
Okay.
Hearing the harpsichord, very likely, if you have a good trained ear,
yes.
you will be able to tell if it's a Flemish type plate, or French type plate, or an Italian type plate, or if it's a virginal plate, like this is a virginal. So they're very different. They come in all kinds of shapes and sizes, all kinds of sounds, all kinds of combinations of strings, and I will talk about it later too. So there are just so much variety, and I love switching from instrument to instrument. I really love playing piano, then playing harpsichord, then I also play organ.
Okay.
Then I play also fortepiano, which is an instrument that was a direct ancestor of a piano,
mm-hmm.
and it emerged from a harpsichord.
Okay.
That's how actually piano started, from a person, an Italian man named Bartolomeo Cristofori. In around 1700s, he invented this new action, a piano action, that it was, of course, developed later, and it came to a point of what is
a modern
piano action.
Right.
But he invented this action where a hammer is striking the strings rather than a jack plucking them.
Right.
And the main reason for that was because one thing that is harpsichord does not have is to be able to play loud and soft.
Mm-hmm.
You cannot, by just pushing the key, no matter how you can, I can push it as hard as I want and I can push it as little as I want.
That's it.
There's no change in the sound. There's practically no change in the dynamics. Right. On the piano, of course, it directly depends on how hard you push the key. So that was one of the disadvantages of the harpsichord. And he came up with this action that resolved this problem.
Okay.
So that was the main reason, actually, why the piano actually was created. And forte piano means loud and soft in Italian.
Right. So my understanding, and I'm not an expert at all, was the fact that to make it louder was the evolution of actually how performances were played. So originally in the 15, 16, 1700s, 1800s, you went to a salon, to a room.
Exactly.
And there a harpsichord was fine because it was big enough to fill the room.
Right.
As concert halls start to come into acceptance in the late 1800s, so certainly into the 19th century, 20th century, you start to have Carnegie Halls.
Yeah.
Where they're gigantic hall, and the harpsichord sound was going to be lost in a 5,000 seat auditorium.
Right.
And so you create then the piano with its
sound,
88 keys, and the pedals, which you don't seem to have on a harpsichord.
No, we don't.
So that's the big sound. The big sound is actually just rich men wanted to fill up Carnegie Hall, and so they needed an instrument to be able to sound that.
Exactly. Well, I would say the reason to invent the piano was to have this variety in the sound, but the reason to make a piano louder, more complicated, and bigger, have more keys, is that reason, that exact reason. Actually, just a funny story, to entertain the listeners, is that Beethoven, very early in his life, in his 20s, started becoming deaf. By the end of his life, he was practically completely deaf, composing all the genius music he composed.
Mm-hmm.
And part of the reason why the piano was becoming louder was because Beethoven couldn't hear it anymore. So he had to actually come to the piano builders and say, build me a piano that has more strings to per one hammer, that is louder, that is bigger. I can't hear them. So he was, he helped the progress. And actually one of the pianos that was built for Beethoven has 4 strings per hammer. He still couldn't hear them, unfortunately. He still, by the story, I know when he performed, when he conducted his ninth symphony at the first performance, when he finished, there was an ovation in the hall. He didn't turn because he didn't hear it.
He didn't hear the noise.
I don't know how he conducted, but that's the story.
Yes.
And he composed most famous genius music he composed.
He was already deaf. Interesting, yes. Yeah.
That's why he's a genius. That's not a harpsichord story, but that's...
Yes, exactly. So what do you want to play for us now?
So now I'd like to play... this was Bach, so this was a representative of a German school.
Mm-hmm.
Now, this is an Italian harpsichord, and Italian-style harpsichord, and there was a German style of harpsichord. They were, they were actually a lot similar to the Italian. So it's a pretty normal thing to play a Bach on this kind of harpsichord. Now, I would like to play something coming from France.
Okay.
And for that, I need to change my music.
Yes.
This time I'm going to be playing from the real music, not from the iPad. And this piece has an interesting story to it, another funny story.
Okay.
This is called Les Sauvages, and the translation is Savages.
Mm-hmm.
It's written by Jean-Philippe Rameau. It's part of one of his very famous suites for harpsichord. And the funny story about it is that this piece is about American Indians. The story is, one time, I believe, in the 1720s, he went to a show where there were, I believe, 4 chiefs of American Indians from Louisiana who came and performed a little concert. So the rhythms and the melodies of the concert influenced him, and he decided to write this piece, and I don't mean to be insulting, but he called it savages.
Yes.
They were savages for him, for the, you know, the refined French music, which, you know, it was at the time, you know, what their rhythms were probably quite shocking, so that's why he named it that. So anyway, here's the savages, and it doesn't sound really like savages, but oh well.
One thing is that you slowly bring your fingers off the keys. Is that a harpsichord thing? I don't see that in a piano playing.
I just marvel your questions. It is a harpsichord thing. And the reason for that is because when you release a key, there's a little bit of noise if you listen carefully. So the faster you release it, the more you have the noise. So I need to release it as slow as I can so there's no action noise coming up from the action.
Interesting. So if I'm a young person and I started to play the piano and I decide, well, maybe I'd like to study this, can I go to the New England Conservatory or to the Hart School of Music and study now the harpsichord?
Yes, absolutely. Actually, I believe New England Conservatory has harpsichords, an early music department where you can study harpsichord. I personally went to Moscow Conservatory, Moscow Tchaikovsky Conservatory, because I'm from Moscow originally. And they have an early music department there. The interesting thing is that it's not just an early music department. It's also a contemporary music department. So I had to have a double work to do. Mm-hmm. I had to play both modern piano and harpsichord and the fortepiano and some clavichord, which is another very interesting instrument for the next time, maybe. Mm-hmm. And I also went to Juilliard School. They recently opened this department called the Historical Performance Department. So I went there for my master's, and I finished it in 2012. Mm. And now I'm actually at Stony Brook that has another harpsichord
Stony Brook department.
In university.
In Long Island?
In Long Island.
Oh, okay.
Yep. And what is more, I can get my doctorate there. That's what I'm working on right now.
Oh, my goodness. Okay. Yes. So, but this is relatively new, would you say? It's not like within the last 20 years or so. Or is it?
I would tell you, I don't know what's the earliest school that started early music first. It might have been Oberlin in America.
Ohio.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
They have a very big early music department,
well
as Indiana University has another very big early music department. Juilliard only started his historical performance department in 2009.
Oh, okay.
But they had a harpsichord. You could get a harpsichord degree before that.
I see.
But there was no... The difference is that just a harpsichord degree is not, how to say it, as an early music specialist, you actually have to collaborate with other early music specialists, other early instruments like baroque violins, baroque oboes, lutes, viola da gambas. And for that, you need to have a whole department having, you know, the students
right.
from this.
Right, so you can have an orchestral setting.
Yes, so you, that's, yes, exactly, that's it.
That's what they want you to have, the performance yes. experience of being with in an orchestra.
Precisely.
Now, you play predominantly solo. Is that what your you think of your career as?
That's what I really like to do, because the main reason for that is I can do whatever I want.
Mm-hmm.
When you play in the ensemble, it's inevitable that there are certain things you have to adjust to the other people. And in the orchestras, you really have to be mostly like a person who holds the rhythm of the orchestra together mm-hmm. and gives their beat and gives their, holds them together time-wise. So I do like to play solo a lot. However, I do play in the orchestras. I played recently in the city.
New York City.
In New York City, I played the St. Matthew Passion.
Oh, the St. Matthew Passion,
on
yes.
On Good Friday.
Yes.
Yeah, I was sitting in the orchestra, in the second orchestra. I played a lot in the orchestra when I was at Juilliard. As a matter of fact, I participated in the orchestra that was led by such famous early music specialists as William Christie, Christopher Hogwood, who just died, Monica Haggett, who else? Nicholas McGuigan. So, yeah, that's the opportunity the Juilliard School gives you
right,
to perform
right,
with this
right.
kind of. Early
the other famous performing school is the Curtis Institute in Philadelphia, where
exactly.
it also trains a lot of solo pianists, at least. I don't know about harpsichord.
They have a solo harpsichord degree, but they don't have an early music program.
Mm-hmm.
They don't have the full education for the early music specialists.
Right. So are we going to play another piece now?
Absolutely. Before I play, I would actually like to say, this last piece, if you notice, there was one place where the harpsichord started sounding differently.
Ah.
And the reason for that was because, this glass of water. So, as you can see, another little technical,
yes.
interesting technical detail. There are two rows of jacks here. The back row, it's on, you know, for me, it's on the back and the front row of jacks.
Right.
And the reason for that is because there's not one set of strings.
Mm.
There are two sets of strings that you can play either by themselves or at the same time. They're in the same pitch, but they have a slightly different sound. So if you just play only one of them, that's what it sounds like. When you add the second one, your sound is louder. And if you, so I was playing this row of jacks first, then I played both of them at the same time, and this one by itself would sound pretty quiet. So that's another difference from the piano. You have different settings that you can use.
Right.
It's not just one sound that you use throughout. There are other options, like it can sound like a lute. If you put a buff, what I call a buff stop, which is pretty much just pieces of felt that are pressed against the strings.
Oh, okay.
And once it's engaged, you have this lute-like sound, which this instrument doesn't have. Italian instruments, they don't have that. But the French and Flemish types of instruments, they do have this what's so-called buff buttons.
Right.
Another option that you can have, you don't have on Italian instruments ever, but you have on the Flemish type of instruments and the French type of instruments and German type of instruments, you can have this is called an 8-foot register, means your regular pitch. But that instruments, they have a 4-foot register. Organs have the same thing. They have
okay.
much more of them. But it means that you have another set of strings that are shorter and they sound one octave higher than the regular pitch. Okay. And you can also have a set of strings that will be a little bit longer and much thicker, and it can sound one octave lower. It's called the 16-foot register, but that's very rare.
All right. And all these are developed because the composer just wants to challenge themselves in terms of making different kinds of sounds?
Right. It's not even because of the composers. It's because it gives you so much variety that they were developed. Yeah, absolutely. And actually, for that matter, yes, some composers lately, they started writing pieces intended for an instrument that has more options in it, like a 4-foot. So it sounds, so pretty much you would be playing this note, but it would sound like this.
Mm-hmm.
So you can play some pieces that are written, they're written for the, to be played on the 4-foot. So they sound really tinkly up there, very high.
And just because there's an artistic challenge and they decide, well, I want a somewhat different sound.
Variety, yeah. Yes, you always want to write in the instrument.
Right. Okay. You get tired of doing the same thing and you want to explore more options. You know, the difference between just simply plucking a violin and putting the bow to the string.
Exactly. Exactly. And plus, you know, if you play a solo concert on a harpsichord that lasts 1 hour, if it's just one sound, you will get bored pretty quickly. Believe me, you want something more variety in the sound.
Okay. All right. Please the audience.
Yes, absolutely. And please the performer too, and the composer, and for that matter, and at that times, most of the performers were also composers themselves, or at least improvisers.
All right.
Which we don't have now anymore. It's very separate. So the next, let me switch to this instrument.
Sure, of course. And describe this one, because for me, I see this absolutely beautiful instrument with painted with roses
and
a beautiful dark wood.
Right.
So that it looks completely different. In fact, it has a lid like a piano.
Exactly.
Quite different. So why don't you kind of describe, if you could, something about this instrument, and then you can then play for us.
Yes. So this is called the virginal, and it's a type of a harpsichord, and as I mentioned before, they come in all kinds of shapes and sizes.
Right.
And this one is, of course, much smaller, so it's actually can accommodate, can fit into a much smaller room, and nevertheless, it still sounds pretty loud. Pretty much, it's almost louder than this one.
It does. And that's is made possible because the length of the string is different?
No. You know what? It's a complicated question.
Okay.
The easiest way to answer it, if you take a violin, it will sound louder than a harpsichord.
Yes.
And it's how many times smaller.
Right. Right.
So it really depends on a bunch of factors. This one... I think it actually having a smaller soundboard makes it easier.
Amplifies the sound?
Well, they all amplify the sound, but when you have a smaller soundboard, you have a smaller piece of wood to move.
Okay.
So, so you need less energy to move. So you can give it, so the same amount, the same hardness of pluck can give you more sound just because there's less wood.
Okay, so this is like a physics answer, right? Right.
Right. Exactly. Also, it can be you can voice them, means you can make them sound pluck harder or softer, and that of course also makes influences how loud the instrument will be. If the strings are a little bit thicker generally throughout, I mean, there are different thicknesses used on the instrument throughout the instrument as well as on the pianos. But if generally the strings are thicker, that makes it louder too.
Okay.
If they're thinner, it makes it softer.
All right.
So there's a bunch of factors that contributes to this.
And how large is the keyboard?
This keyboard is compared to this one.
Looks smaller.
This one goes from C to D. This one, I believe, is a little bit bigger. Actually, it goes from G to F. So it's bigger range.
Oh, all right.
What's interesting, though, that in the bass, right after G, you don't have A. You have C. And the reason for that is because for the music of that time, they almost never needed A and B so low. But they needed G and they needed C. So they got rid of the two keys because in the bass it's actually hard to make them sound good. So the less bass notes you have, the better they will sound.
All right.
So you actually do not need this additional A and B. So this just a quick word about what the instrument this is. Clearly it has an English name. Virginal.
Okay.
But this one is an Italian virginal.
Mm-hmm.
They were English virginals also. But they were, they're different. I'm not going to go into full technical details what the difference is. In short, they're clearly smaller. The clearly shape is different. The big difference is that the strings run perpendicular to the keyboard rather than like this
straight ones ahead.
Continue the keyboard.
I
this
see.
One run across.
It. Okay, all right.
So that's one big difference. Another big difference is not on this instrument, but on some types of virginals, the strings rather than being plucked closer to the front.
Mm-hmm.
They're plucked in the middle,
okay.
So it gives a very interesting boomy sound.
Ah.
But it's not the case with this one.
Okay.
Anyway.
One would be amazed at the variety that there is in a harpsichord, because who would know, right?
Yes.
You think one tinny little sound? No. Lots of variation.
Yes.
In fact, you're right. Much more variation in sound than a modern piano, actually.
Yes, exactly. Exactly. And unfortunately, I can't show you a different, because the instruments I brought here, they don't have these options. But some of them, they have this option of this buff baton, for example. It sounds like a lute. So I'm going to play for you this interesting short piece. Just a short story. Before I play it, another funny story. It's called La Volta. It's a dance.
Oh, okay.
And this is a music, this is a Renaissance music. What I was playing before was Baroque.
Right.
This is a music of time of the Renaissance. It was written at the very early 16th century, I believe it's the 15th, 16th century. And it was written by a very famous composer of the time, William Byrd. What's interesting that this dance was a kind of, it was not a court dance. It was a dance for mostly for the peasants. And the funny thing is about it, it has lips in it. And the reason for that was because apparently, the leaping were women in the dance, not the men. And the men helped women leap.
Oh, okay.
And the reason for that was because in that case, their skirts would go up and they could see what was below the skirts, and I think they were not even wearing the
they were not wearing underwear.
So you can see that there's like a big sexual context to it.
Okay.
And actually this dance was, from what I heard, it was in favor of Queen Elizabeth I.
Ah, okay.
And I'm sure
this is then English music.
This is an English music.
Okay.
And this is this book, this and that book I have there. These are called the Fitzwilliam Virginal Book.
Okay.
And this is the absolutely biggest collection of the music for the keyboard instruments of that time.
Mm.
It has hundreds of pieces in it.
Mm-hmm.
And by all kinds of composers and all kinds of names, and some of the names I wouldn't even dare to announce here because they're really inappropriate. So they were quite, you know, playful at the time.
I love it, playful.
Yeah, so here's some playful music for you.
I think you could cure the lips pretty much, right?
Yes, and also that it does have a different sound than the one you played, the other one that you, the other harpsichord that you played. A different sound, you can hear it. I'm kind of tone deaf, but I can certainly hear that there is a difference. And I suppose, you know, it's because it's been constructed differently to have a different sound on purpose.
Yes, absolutely. Absolutely.
And so what you played as a model of what actually instrument looked like in Elizabethan England?
Yeah. They had this kind of shape. Some of the instruments had this kind of shape. Some of them were just shaped as a rectangular box.
Okay, I've seen those on the performing. Yes.
Yes. And these were actually called musillars. These were the ones that had the pluck. They were plucked in the middle of the string.
Oh, okay.
They also had Italian harpsichords in England at the time, so I could as well play this music on this instrument. That's what I'm planning to do later, to have another piece played.
Okay.
I wanted to talk a little bit about the factory.
Absolutely. Put a plug in for the company that is nationally renowned here right in our little community.
It's not nationally. It's
internationally renowned.
Yes.
Right in our little community.
And you wouldn't, you know, so I met quite a few people who were surprised to know that actually right here in Stonington, 65 Cutler Street, right across Zach's Bar and Grill restaurant, we have a whole biggest in the country factory that produces early keyboard instruments. We don't just produce harpsichords. We also produce clavichords, fortepianos. I believe they even tried to produce an organ, but it didn't go well. But mostly it's harpsichords and harpsichord-like instruments.
Right.
The family of harpsichord instruments, clavichords, and fortepianos. And this factory is also one of the oldest ones existing. I believe they started in 1950s, late 1950s. The founder, his name was Wolfgang Zuckermann. He was one of these amateur people who got so interested in harpsichords that he wanted to build one. And he started going around visiting famous harpsichord makers like Frank Hubbard or Willem Dowd and asking them about the harpsichord. They gave him information and he came up with a very funny little model called the Z-Box, if we could have it on the screen.
We have a photograph of the of the Z-Box.
Yeah.
That
it's the second photograph that yes, this is the Z-Box. This is the instrument that I personally just finished working on.
Mm-hmm.
This was a number 25 harpsichord produced at the factory. It has a number 25 on it. It was produced in 1958.
I see.
And so it was one of the very first harpsichords that they started making.
And it sits on top of a table?
It sits on top of a table.
So it's like it's really small.
It is really small. It's shorter than this one. It has actually bigger range. It has more keys.
Really?
It does.
Okay.
And it sounds, it actually has a pretty nice sound for what it is. It is not a historical copy.
Okay.
But it has a pretty nice virginal-like sound.
Uh-huh.
And they were making them first as finished instruments. And then at some point, Wolfgang Zuckermann got so many orders for them that he got frustrated. He said, you know what? I'm going to make kits. Sell them to people for $150.
And people put them together themselves.
That's how much it cost that time, you know?
Okay.
And so people were buying them. They produced thousands of these instruments.
Mm.
All over the country, they went to the schools. They went to the amateurs. They went to the professionals. They went outside of the country, there are thousands of them around. And actually, they're not bad instruments. They sound pretty good. And I would say for the amateur who doesn't want to spend a lot of money on that instrument, they can buy one of them.
Right, a lot cheaper than buying a piano.
That's cheaper than buying a piano. And so they sound pretty good. We don't make them anymore. We make a historical copies, kits, too. We are famous for making kits, but we also make plenty of finished instruments like this one or this one.
Right.
But it started from this Z-Box, and frankly, I have like a page of, and this is far from being it, two pages with, you know, two pages of extracts from the newspapers saying how people are grateful, you know, how people were amazed with the quality of sound and how good it sounded.
Came from that, from the kit.
All came from a kit. They put them together themselves, and it was such a joy because at that time, people didn't have much to do.
Right.
You know, to entertain themselves. There was no internet. There was no computers. So what would you do? You put together a harpsichord. You put together one of these.
Yes.
And
we had a group on here as one of my guests who put together harps. Mm-hmm. They made their harps, and then they went ahead and played them.
Exactly.
So, yes, I can understand that.
That's what people are doing. Putting it together, playing it. They could also have it, you know, as a finished instrument, but it was a lot of fun and it was not that difficult to put it together. And it would actually play, sound good, and work.
Right.
So it was, you know, imagine how you would never hear from a harpsichord before and then you hear about them, you get interested, you find out that you can get a kit for not much money.
Right.
And put it together yourself and play it.
Yes.
I mean, that's almost like a miracle.
Yes.
So Wolfgang Zuckermann had this genius idea. He was the first one starting a harpsichord kit.
Mm-hmm.
And, eventually, he moved more towards the making historical copies of the instruments. And then, I think, in 1969 or 1970, he actually sold the factory that at the time it was in the city, in New York City, and on Christopher Street in Greenwich Village.
In Greenwich Village, yes, sure. On the west side of Greenwich Village, Christopher Street, sure.
You know even better. I haven't been there yet.
Yes.
But he sold the factory to a person named David Way. He later started calling himself, to sound more Frenchy, David Jacques Way. What he did, he bought the factory and he became one of these famous harpsichord makers making the copies of the antique instruments, more and more of them. And we still use his designs to build the instruments. And he was very famous. Some of the instruments that were produced by the factory are actually signed with his name.
Wow.
Some of them are signed as Zuckermann. Mm-hmm. I think he mostly finished instruments at that time were signed David Jacquet and the kits were signed Zuckermann. Now we sign finished instruments Zuckermann, and kits can have a signature of a person who would finish them. He ran the factory producing many, many different kinds of instruments until 1994 when he died. And then current owner Richard Ober, he bought off factory from his widow, and now he's the one producing the harpsichords. And I came to the factory in 2013 as an intern because I am very sure that any professional harpsichordist should be able to maintain their own harpsichords. And I'm sure that that's what they were doing in the ancient times, and that's what the famous harpsichordists are doing now. For example, Gustav Leonhardt, who was like a god of harpsichord in 20th century, he just died. He was the most famous harpsichordist in the 20th century. He absolutely could voice his own harpsichord, change a string, you know, tuning, it's inevitable. You have to tune
it. Yes, you have to learn, no matter what instrument you play, you have to learn how to tune it.
Yes,
absolutely.
With the piano, you don't have to.
No, you use the piano to tune everything else.
Exactly. But you have professional tuners. But for the harpsichord, they need much more tunings than a piano. They're much more susceptible to any kind of temperature or humidity changes. So they need tunings very often. As a matter of fact, by the end of the show, this will be a little bit out of tune already.
Well, we're running out of time, so I want you to... So when did they move to Stonington?
They moved to Stonington... I believe end of 70s, because by the beginning of 80s, a friend of mine was already working there.
Okay.
And they actually had, there are so many people around in the area who used to work for Zuckermann. So
we have this Sonnington gem that many people who are not musicians might not know about it.
Exactly.
So, Elena, I want you to tell the audience where you will be performing so that they can hear not only from these two instruments, but other kinds of pieces that you perform.
I will be playing, so my next concert that it will be in the area will be at the Lagra Center in Stonington on June 11th, which is Saturday, at 1 o'clock.
Okay, and that's a Saturday at 1 o'clock at Lagrua Center, which is in Stonington Borough.
Yes.
In the beautiful limestone building, mm-hmm. right there in Stonington Borough. So you can mm-hmm. have a light lunch at one of the many restaurants in Stonington.
Yes.
And then drive your car down and park and hear you play. 1 o'clock, yes. June 11th.
Free entrance.
Free. Okay, yes. that's even better.
It's but, that good.
And, do we have other dates that we might be thinking? I know that you're talking about doing another date in the August.
Yes.
Somewhere also nearby?
Yes. It will be in Watch Hill Chapel, I believe at 7:30 in the evening on August 27th. But it might change. So if you can just, you know, check their site.
Okay. And also, do you have a site where people can contact you?
I don't have my site. I have an email, however.
Okay.
Yes,
there it is. All right.
Any questions?
PANURG1@gmail.com.
That's right.
I'm not even going to ask what it means, but, you know, that's fine. Do you give harpsichord lessons?
Absolutely.
Okay, so people who would like to learn how to play can go ahead and contact, Elena from this, email account,
mm-hmm.
and you can give people lessons.
Yes.
Children,
adults.
To seniors.
Harpsichord, clavichord. Piano, I would not dare to teach an organ because I don't have a formal education.
But you also teach piano as well?
Yes. Oh, absolutely.
Okay, yeah. So this is a just all-around good teacher, and you have an opportunity to learn the harpsichord, which, is it easier, as difficult, or the same as learning a piano?
It's easier in some ways. It is more difficult in some other ways, and I would say physically it's easier.
Mm-hmm.
Mind-wise, you know, just how much thinking you have to put into it, it's probably in some ways harder, and it's very different from playing the piano. And don't ever listen to someone who can tell you, oh, I can play a harpsichord because I play piano. No, you
can't. Not true. Not true.
No, absolutely not.
You have to make adjustments.
Not just adjustments. It's a new technique to learn. It's a new instrument to learn. It's the whole new world to learn about how to play this music. It's very different from playing, you know, 19th century romantic music. That's what we're used to playing. 19th century, 20th century, you know.
Piano.
Very different.
Right, right. All right. But if you're interested in early music,
mm-hmm.
Elena is the ones to teach you how to play it.
Yeah.
And
I can do
because
that.
Most people probably don't have it at home, do they come to you to learn how to play it?
Well, we can actually arrange, we can figure something out how to do that.
Right.
They can also maybe either borrow instruments from the factory or buy some instruments from the factory. There's
right.
some
Zuckerman.
Used instruments.
Yes.
Z-Box
yes.
is a very good instrument for someone who wants to start playing a harpsichord, and they're really cheap.
Okay, good. So. And they would contact Zuckermann in Stonington to go ahead and get a
yes,
get
absolutely.
An instrument.
And just, you know, you can come. Contact us, come visit anytime. We also have some beautiful paintings and antiques there because there's some antique restoration going on. And there's a ton of beautiful instruments right now we have.
Okay.
So I brought only two, but we have much more.
All right, Zuckermann in Stonington, a you know, wonderful, wonderful gem that many people may not be aware of who are not musicians. And I want to thank my guest, Elena, for coming here and playing these wonderful instruments, teaching us about the harpsichord. Remember, June 11th, she's got a concert at La Grua in Stonington Borough, not far, beautiful location. It's free. Come on by. And let's put her email back on if you want information about the harpsichord, if you want to take lessons or learn about taking lessons. there's the person to contact. So I want to thank you very much for being my guest.
Thank you very much for having me here. It was a pleasure.
So, my audience, I give you a little bit of everything. So if you didn't know anything about the harpsichord, maybe knew a little thing about a piano, you learned an awful lot today. So I want to thank you for joining us. This is Harriet Grayson, your host and producer of Community Culture Showcase. Bye-bye. See you around soon.